Well, shit, this isn't good enough because it doesn't sound like whatever they're used to releasing. So I actually reapproached it, and that was a blessing because I wasn't fully connected to that song anyways how it was. So, like, that's kind of a side thing. That allowed me to take some space. But there's this whole problem in the industry where, like, a lot of you guys who are just starting out or just starting to release music or whatnot, you know, you really want to get signed by a label. It's almost like the label is the end all be all. And because now it's not as much about, like, I want to sign a Universal, I want to sign an Interscope. It's like, I want to sign a track to X label. That's kind of been the stigma that's been created. You know, once your track gets on Proximity or Trap Nation or whatever, you've made it. I can tell you that all of that's happened to me, and that's not true. It doesn't just mean that you're done. It shouldn't be the end all be all, because the people that are making the decisions about music most of the time are not musicians. They're not creatives. They don't understand what it is to be an artist and to try to endeavor to innovate, you know. At least that's my experience. And I'm sick and tired of trying to produce this orchestral sound that is getting attention and getting validation from you guys, which feels amazing. But I'm also a human. So when these label heads or these people, oh, your music's too long, the buildups are too long, our audience isn't going to have the attention span, or it's not playlistable. Those are all things that really, really, really shape your own cognition of what you're doing. And it's a fucking mental game, you know? Like, you start to think, well, why can't my music fit in Xbox? And if the answer is because it isn't ready yet, or it doesn't sound like everything else, or whatever, it doesn't necessarily mean it's bad. It just means that there isn't a platform for it, which inherently is okay, because you think about all the trendsetters, like Avicii, like Kygo. I don't know if you guys saw the Ultra where Avicii premiered his new, like, Wake Me Up when he brought folk singers out. Everybody booed, and he headlined Ultra that year because he had live performers. He had, you know, he had the soulful experience. It was like a band versus just a DJ. And everybody booed. And then Wake Me Up went on to crush records. So, like, that was almost an example of being before its time. So it's kind of hard because, you know, I sit here and I'll be honest, like, I'm 32. I just turned 32. And I'm like, I love what I'm doing, but I'm also on the other side frustrated because I see guys that play the game, play the system, release music that sounds like Seven Lions, and then he supports them on tour, and then they go off and do other things, or people copy Illenium, then they're Said This Guy, and they're dabbing. Like, I'm not shitting on those guys. I just think that a lot of that music lacks innovation. It's just safe. And not, it doesn't mean that it's not good. It doesn't mean that you can't build a fan base around that, but, like, I think a lot of the reason why I've been having so many struggles with this sort of stuff is because I'm trying to inject emotion and realism in a way that's, like, kind of flying in the face of contemporary expectation within the music industry right now. And again, it doesn't mean that I'm shitting on those guys or they're not as good. It's more so, like, I'm trying to figure this out for myself, right? And the worst thing you can do, I think, is make those creative decisions because other people tell you that your music has to be more marketable. You know, God, the fucking number one. Oh, you got to make it shorter because it has to go on a Spotify playlist. It's like, well, what the fuck, man? Like, no, you know, like, my initial instincts is fuck that. I don't care if it gets 1,000 streams. I'd rather stay true to what I want and hope that me making something that I'm proud of is going to resonate with fans in some way because it has that realness to it. What's authenticity that hasn't been sculpted by just traditional expectation, you know? So anyways, that's my rant. So in having said that, playing the devil's advocate of that approach when they didn't give me great feedback on the song, sort of reapproached it. I honestly just bounced the vocal and I went to my piano and I started playing, and I think I actually wrote a better song. So sometimes it can work, because I will say that oftentimes we as artists get way too close to our music and we lose our objectivity. We lose the, is this actually good or do I just love what I did? You know, and that's where your ego comes in. So much of this ties back to psychology. It's fascinating, but it's also maddening. Fuck, you guys are writing a lot, so let me read some of this. Sorry. Make your own sublabel. Yeah, I've actually talked about that with Don. Don is urging me to do that. He thinks that this is what my sound needs because I have to craft an ecosystem within artists that understand a way that I write and that it's not going to sound exactly like all the other stuff. Music tells the story of an artist. I totally agree. Yeah, it has to feel human and it has to feel authentic. Because, like, otherwise, why the fuck are we doing this? Like, I know I'm not doing this. I wouldn't be struggling to build this thing and to be in LA for all these years if I just wanted to go on a quick tour and then call it a day. Like, I'm trying to grow as an artist and make the most unique things that I can, and not get colored by the business decisions that the industries that we are subjected to often push on artists, you know? Everybody thinks they know the right way, but it's not unique anymore. Mix is too long or doesn't fit our playlist. Exactly. Right. So if your goal is to elicit emotion and feeling, stay true to the things that move you. You know what I mean? Like, that's the barometer I always use. Am I moved by this? If I can play this acoustic, right, just like with a vocal and a piano, or guitar. I can't really play the guitar, but if you can play the guitar, if you can play it in its raw form without all the bells and whistles, without the drop, that stuff's all great, but like, it has to be a good song. I'm vehemently against sending instrumentals to top laners. I really don't think that works because there's something about, like, I wrote that song with Alicia in the room and, you know, it means something. It has a tie to what's going on. You know, it's about saying goodbye to say it's real. It was written because of somebody, you know, and we'll get into that later when this release takes shape. But like, there has to be a story. It can't just be like, oh yeah, I sent my vocal to somebody and they wrote a cool top line because they know how to write melodies. And if you really want to make people cry, you have to cry making it. Like, let's just say that. So I don't know. That's just my rant, I guess. Flume's another example. Flume is an innovator. He's insane. That remix that he did of Disclosure that they played at Coachella or whatever, like in 2016, when people are like, how is this guy doing this? And then he's able to be on the radio, but he's also still making really interesting sounding music. Like, yeah, it's absolutely mind blowing. It's fucking awesome. So yeah, I've heard that before. Play the game, reach a high point, then do what you want to do. Honestly, man, that's disingenuous. I really think, I mean, there might be a part of me doing that. If a label says we love this, but like, take out this part that makes the song 8 seconds shorter and it doesn't fuck with the artistic direction that I wanted to take it in, fine. I can make that concession. But when labels are like, your orchestral buildups are too long, or, you know, your buildups need to be quicker, you need to get to the drop faster, it's like, yes, Chainsmokers, that's a good example. Like, they were put into a box and they dropped off the face of the earth because they're trying to reinvent themselves creatively. They're trying to find that creative outlet because it's been lost by the mainstream attention. And I don't know if that's the whole story, but exactly. I mean, Roses was so cool. Roses was like, when they dropped that, they probably didn't expect it to go that big. You know, Don't Let Me Down, so cool. Production, innovative. The songwriting was innovative, you know, and it just worked. It was timing. And then everything after that was pushed. It felt forced, or at least that's my analysis. Yeah, and like, obviously this is just my opinion, but I struggle with this every day, probably just as you guys do. You know, if you're wanting to produce, if you're wanting to make a career out of this, it's this push and pull between wanting fans, wanting attention, but like, I don't want to release shit that's just cool, that just like, oh yeah, this bangs, whatever. It has to do something, or at least that's my endeavor. That's like my outlook. That's what I want my music to do. Anyways, what else is I going to talk about? Shit. Yeah, I love you guys. I really appreciate that. And this is why I love doing these. Like, people have messaged me. They're like, oh, you only have like 18, 20 people like tuning into these at a time. I'm like, who fucking cares? Like, I want to talk about this. I want to talk about this with you guys. I want to ask questions. I want you guys to ask questions. I want to, you know, connect in that way. Even if it's with a smile, it doesn't, to me, it doesn't matter. You know, like, I put that set up yesterday so you guys could see, if you haven't seen me live, what it looks like. I mean, there's not a lot of people there. We only did a socially distanced version of a pool party. But, you know, it, if you do it right and your song only gets 1,000 plays, but you were happy with the way that it worked, it's okay. Feel like the energy that's connected to that release will carry your music and your career, versus I've signed tracks that I was like, this piece of work is amazing, you know? And then the release got so clouded by bureaucratic politics bullshit that, I don't know, like, it didn't really do well. And I'm not going to say what song that was. I don't want to talk shit about the label, but things happen and you really have to just listen to yourself. Come to Michigan. Funny enough, I am coming to Michigan in a few weeks. I have a family vacation that we do every other year. That's why I'm quarantining and being careful for a few weeks. It's my entire family. We're going to Manitou Beach. It's like, I don't know if I'm holding this right. It's like right down here. It's right near the border of Indiana, but it's a small man-made lake. So yeah, I will see you in Michigan. What's up, Marcus? How you doing? Yeah, so that's just, you know, like, in like, I fired my manager. I don't know if I told you guys this. We parted ways like a month or two ago because we weren't seeing eye to eye. And I kind of have another guy, that guy, Josh, who's helping manage me and like his understanding where I'm going. But like, this whole industry is backwards right now. And it's made evident by the fact that artists that have been relying heavily or exclusively on touring income are now, I'm talking to artists that are a million plus monthlies on Spotify, that have, you know, hundreds of millions of plays on YouTube, that are having to get second jobs right now, that are having to step away from music because they have to make money, because that's how toxic the streaming environment is for artists and for their splits, especially when you sign to a label. You guys might not know this, but when you sign your music to Proximity or The District, which is the parent company, they carve out 100% of royalties from their channels. So if your song gets a few million plays on Trap Nation or Proximity, that's all ad rev that they're taking. You're going to get money from Spotify, but they put all their marketing and all their push behind their YouTube channels. So these companies are making hundreds of thousands of dollars, if not more, a month on all the uploads, and you are seeing nothing. So if you think that's fair, okay. But like, this is just another example of capitalist bureaucratic greed. Like, why can't artists afford to do this? It's because like, your music goes up online and you're going to make a little off Spotify, you know, but still it's like 0.0003. It's like $4,500 per million, but then that's whittled down and then that's split. If your music does well on YouTube or anything that falls under that umbrella, like, you're giving them your music for free. That's what I want you to realize. Like, it took me years to realize how unfair this was. There's this whole thing with them signing your track and a label then owns your master. You can keep your publishing, but like, they own your master percentage and they can do whatever they want with it, and they can take all the money from their carved out channels. They're not even paying you 50-50 from YouTube revenue. So that's what it looks like to have a song on Trap Nation or Proximity. Like, I have a lot of music on there, but I knew that I wasn't going to make money from it. But it's just unfair because it's almost like a trade-off. Like, you do that in the hopes that it will expose you to more fans. You're paying for, in a way, or giving up your money so that you can have that exposure to jumpstart your career, to start to tour. Like, that's the hope. But it's too one-sided. You should have three streams of revenue in any aspect of life. You shouldn't just have one, because if one falls apart, then you don't have any money. Same thing with music. There's multiple streaming revenues that an artist creates for himself, but the fact that labels, and this goes for majors too, there's a reason why it's so expensive to go see artists. It's because we all know that they rely on touring income to survive. Well, now that's gone. So a label that traditionally takes 81 cents on the dollar, 82, when Justin Bieber has a song that crosses a billion plays, like, it's millions of dollars that the label is taking most of, and they just have you in these deals. The whole thing is backwards. And this is why artists start their own imprints, and it's smart, but then, like, they start adopting these practices. They want to own your music. They don't want to, you know what I mean? It's like having control of everything is what it's all about. And unfortunately, it's the very reason why so many people just never break. They just do this as a hobby. They have the talent, but they can't cross over to making money from it because they can't just all of a sudden start making $5,000 every time they DJ. You know what I mean? So, and of course, there are other ways of money. I'm of course making this more of a general argument, but like, that's the way of the world, and it's not fucking right, you know? So when you think, my number one goal is to sign music to Proximity, sign to Trap Nation, I'm not shitting on those labels particularly. They are part of a bigger system that has enabled the entire system to take advantage. It's like Jeff Bezos and Amazon. He's making fucking millions of dollars a day, and he's the richest person in the world, and his workers are barely able to afford not only a livable wage, but PPE. It's like, that's kind of a good representation. It's just how capitalism has survived. And we won't get too far into that because that's a whole nother conversation. But so just think twice about where you want your music to go and what you're willing to trade for not only the sculpting and the advice and the necessities that these A&Rs put on you in terms of, oh, well, we want to sign your track, but not only if it sounds like this. They're operating from a business standpoint. They want to have your music sound like what their label, their listeners are going to enjoy, so they get more streams and their music performs better. It's just business. So they're not coming to you from a creative standpoint, so you have to protect yourself from that, just like obviously I do. So what do I think we should do? Conspiracy theories. I'm not so big on conspiracy theories. It's just the reality, guys. It's not a conspiracy theory when you're able to deduce it for yourself, when you're able to, I've gone through this. Like, I've seen these deals. I know how unfair it is. It's not conspiracy. The problem is, it is all the guys that are 14, 15 years old that are maybe really good producers, but they don't have smart, they don't have a business acumen, they don't have experience. They don't know what a good contract looks like. They get a track signed by Proximity or Lowly, and all they do is fucking sign it. They don't even read it. They don't even read it. So when that's the norm, taking a stance against those, and believe me, I've done it, you get demonized. You get, oh, well, we don't want to, we're not going to do business with you because you're being dramatic or like your demands are too crazy. It's like, no, I'm just asking for respect. Like, no, I'm not. So then like, well, we don't have time. We're just going to stonewall you. Deal falls through. Happens all the time. So the mass amount of people submitting them their music is the type of person that just, the end all be all is getting on Trap Nation. They don't care if they make no money from it. That's just their goal. That's what I'm trying to talk to you about today. It isn't as much about utilizing these platforms as leverage. I'm not saying I'm not going to sign tracks to Lowly, but you have to be aware of what you're giving away. And like, my music is very cinematic. I make a lot of money off of sync licenses. That's where a lot of my income comes from. So they don't know shit about sync licensing. So a lot of my deals look like, hey, let me handle the sync side so we can bring in third parties to license this for movie trailers, commercials, spots, America's Got Talent, whatever. So the point is, you got to do your research, and you can't just be like, oh, Trap Nation said they're going to sign my track. Fucking tell me where to sign. I don't care what the deal looks like. Perpetuating that stereotype is what has put all of us in this position. That is what I'm trying to get across. What we should do is, I don't know, think for ourselves. Don't, if you really believe in something, don't just give it away. 100,000 streams on a track in a day might look awesome on Trap Nation, but like, it doesn't really, it doesn't mean much because you're not getting paid from it on YouTube. And that doesn't mean you're getting a fan. That just means you got to play, right? There's a huge difference between I have this many plays and I have this many true fans. Those are very different things. Gathering true fans and sort of cultivating that audience is a lot different than your plays or your monthly listeners. You know, followers is really what the metric is. Okay, so now that we've said all that, I think the thing to do is just really have patience. Don't try to undercut the system or get there quicker by sacrificing your music, especially if you believe in it. You have to believe in it, right? So in no way, shape, or form should you just be giving it away and not getting paid for it. It is much better to do self-releases. A really good tool is DistroKid. They will publish your music for you to all the DSPs, and you can enter in all your splits for the different writers. And then when they make their income, they get paid by all the aggregators. They will pay you out per your splits in the song, which is really helpful because then you don't have to like go chase after other artists and give them 1099s and all that stuff. DistroKid is amazing. And you know what? You can still get on Trap Nation if you self-release a song. You can still get on Spotify playlists if you self-release a song. All those things are still possible. And to be honest, a lot of times these labels promise you things or they say, oh, we have connections here. This is why you should sign with us. We're going to get your music here. Does it really happen? Like, maybe. Piracy having too much importance. Piracy is it's a tough topic. I don't know. I mean, I pay for Spotify. I feel like you're doing due diligence at that point. A lot of people use streaming. I don't think a lot of people download music illegally as much as they did. Maybe it still exists, but yeah, I'm not really as versed in that. It's really cheap. DistroKid is like, okay, so the girl that just joined Alicia, that was her voice. Hey Alicia, I'm gonna play through this again so you can hear what I rewrote to Goodbye. You guys got to all follow Alicia. She's amazing. I'm going to do that in one sec. It is cheap. DistroKid is, I think, $19.99 for the year, and it's unlimited uploads. That's insane. $20, maybe $30, but still, like, then you can upload 15 a year. Insane. Yeah. Self-releasing is really not a bad option because you will learn the more control you have over your music as you develop, as you get more into your career, the better. You know, there's songs that you might love that a label owns that you signed a while ago. I have them. Most of my music is signed to labels that they're not doing shit with, and you maybe want to have control over it. You can't unless there's an expiration clause in the contract. I'm gonna play through this one more time so Alicia can hear it. Alicia, this is Goodbye, but it is a new version that I'm writing to piano, okay?
Deep ocean eyes, they speak a language right to my
She liked that. That's the first time she's heard that, guys. yeah. Really pumped about that one. That's a really emotional song. And, yeah, you have feelings. Exactly. We can all top line all day. and write cool lyrics. There's a time and a place for that. I love a good Vegas banger as much as anybody else. But what really connects with me is writing emotional music. You know, that's where I think I can communicate most as an artist. So yeah, that one working on, that's going to be a really, really, really cool release. Once I nail the production, I think I have some ideas of where I'm going to take it. House music. Yes. It'll be a house music remix. So yeah. If you guys have any more questions or you want to bring up other things to discuss, I had some other musical things to talk about, but I can take questions. You know, we can like pivot a little bit. Why don't you guys type some things while I eat my cereal and say hi to Summer. Ah, she's sleeping. She loves these live streams. Thanks, Billy. Yeah, the harmonies. So I went for a verse and a hook that were the same. And then the pre-chorus is sort of the harmonic movement, but it's in reverse. So instead of ending here, I start here and then I climb. Inverted. So we land on A major. A lot of the times I overcomplicate things and I just realize stripping it back and just letting the vocal breathe and like not having too many intricate, amazing, interesting harmonies sometimes is better. Even though as a composer, I'm always like, oh shit, how can I do that modal mixture? I learned piano. Yeah, I played piano in undergrad and I had a lot of private lessons as in the composition program. I just learned to play like that, but I'm not like a great pianist. I can play, it's called like arranger's piano. How often do I use sevenths and ninths? I work a lot using triads. I talk about triads most of your work a while back. Okay, here, I'll just break this down really quick. Here's a little composition lesson. So I start here, A major. So I'm gonna establish the chord progression from the beginning. B minor. So this is F sharp major, it's like a suspension. I love using suspensions. That's how it resolves. So now this is the fourth of A major. So once we have here, it feels good to go back to A major. Just repeat it. Here's a really fun one. So this is a D minor six. Essentially D minor, or I'm sorry, what is this? No, this is a B minor six. So it's essentially B minor with the D in the bass instead of the B. Right, and it sounds diminished. But this also sounds good going back to here. But one cool thing is that in the pre, I just stay down here. And then I climb. So it's just the whole thing in reverse. This is a fun one. So this is another suspension. A G minor suspension, or actually it's E major, but it's with the G sharp in the bass. Right back to A major right, B minor, and then do it again. So the reason why that's nice is because with your bass line, it just keeps going up, right? And then I can fill the chords around that like this. Yep. And this really just, this came about just me playing around the piano, you know? I had this vocal that we recorded and I just didn't like what I had before. I play this for you guys. This was the original. That's not it. Remember?
Deep ocean eyes.
So like that's not bad. It wasn't bad and like it sounds nice, but you know, this is kind of going back to what I was discussing at the beginning. I didn't feel like it was right. There was something, and I talked to Alicia about this. I'm like, I don't know. I got to be honest with you. I got to be honest with myself. There's something about this that, like, it was finished, but I just didn't. I didn't feel like it was. I didn't feel like I was 100% confident with the end result. And I didn't think that was the writing, the vocal writing. I didn't think it was her delivery or her performance. I really thought it was my writing, the harmony. And it was cool, but it, like, you know, I was really trying to hold myself to a high standard and really trying to think, like, does this move me in the way that I want it to? And ironically, when we sent it to those labels, they were like, oh, the mixing and mastering needs work. And I didn't really agree with that, but it was kind of a happy accident that I was like, fuck, I do need to take a step back and, like, revisit how I wrote this. And I did. I didn't touch it for a month. And then the other day I wrote those chords and I feel like it fits so much better. So sometimes finishing music is really hard, but it's better to listen to yourself if something's not right and take a step back from it or reapproach it or keep trying versus being like, oh, it's cool, it's good enough. I don't know. If you don't really believe in it, other people won't really believe in it. It may sound shitty, it may sound too cold, but, like, if you really want your music to get ahead, if you really want to be unapologetically original, you have to believe in wholeheartedly what you're releasing. And that just can't be, oh, this is cool, this is good enough, this top line sounds neat, whatever, we'll just put it out because I need to put out music. Like, I've done that before and it doesn't work, you know? People don't connect with it in the right way. So you really have to be specific. And I'm really glad I did. I'm glad I didn't push this one out. What's up? Hey, from Chile. Juanjo, Juanjo. Arandondo. Sorry, my pronunciation is so bad. Okay, let's keep going. We got a few more minutes. I know I've talked a lot of different stuff. Sorry if I'm annoying you guys with all my predilections about what's wrong in the industry. So that chord, I know if I put that in, labels are going to be like, I don't really know. It, like, doesn't, it sounds kind of weird. Well, yeah, fuck off. It's called emotional, as I'm spitting my cereal everywhere. It's called an emotional play. If I'm making cinematic orchestral tracks that don't drop until 2 minutes, what's your best tips in incorporating new sounds to get you to that drops listeners? Don't fall off. Great question. That's tough. You know what? I'm going to take 10 minutes and I'm going to listen to your demos. Okay. If you have an example of something that you want to ask me a question on, I'll play it and we can reference it. We'll do that. Email me. I'm only going to have time for a few, so I'm going to have to go in order. Here's my email. I'm posting it right there. I'm going to pin it if I can. Send me your demos. We'll talk through them. And you can ask me specific questions. So, oh, you sent yours earlier. Oh, nice. Okay, let's play it. Anybody else, if you want me to listen to some of your tracks, Solified. You didn't put a link in here. I need a link. If you could send me another one. Yeah, that's just text. So, nice. Crazy effect. So did they post it after you released it? Did you self-release that track? He said someone from NCS wanted to sign one of my tracks, knew the minute they emailed me the contract that I wouldn't see a penny from it, right? I just gave them my permission to post it and then you just kept it. Right, so did you release it on your own? And then did they end up posting it? Billy, do you want me to play this demo? Okay, let's play this one from my good friend Billy Van, who I've produced music with for years.
Yeah, I'm making it happen. Follow me, I'm the captain. Put my foot on the gas and go. Here and ready for action. No one does it like Jackson.
Okay.
If it's true, I ain't bragging, no. I got the golden touch.
I see what you mean. Okay, so one idea immediately off the bat. I think you can keep the energy up by just changing the chords, not keeping it on the tonic. You know, that would make it feel, because it was cool in the first bar, second bar, and then when it stayed on that, that's the whole, I think, that felt a little bit monotonous. Because all the other stuff in there is really neat. God, his mixes are so goddamn clean. That would be my only 2 cents on that, Billy. Everything else felt amazing. Loved that. Okay. Solified. Solifide, am I saying that right? Okay, here's one from Solified. This is a remix, Said the Sky. I'll jump to the second chorus after. That chord right there, I'd change. That was good. Oh, is this what I never learned? Should have been hanging on you everywhere. I was taking you for granted. There, right there. You gotta change that bass note. Put strings in this part. Put lush strings. Something over the top for the vocal, that'll give it a new. Because he goes up. Yeah, put more strings and more in the middle part. I would change that note. Good. So this should be building up to a drop. Okay, cool. Yeah, I have some thoughts. Okay, two biggest things. Play with the harmony more. And by harmony, I mean the chords that you're writing, the bass notes that you're using, especially in that verse. Hey, Miracle, good to see you. It was really cool, especially on the drop. I would really redo that harmony. What was it? D major? Maybe do like an F sharp minor. Then B minor. Then G major. Yeah. I would do that. Right back where I come. And then do that in the bass. Because it needs to be straightforward. But your drops and all your fills and all that, it was cool. I really like that. Follow Said the Size. I guarantee you, I think I just played what he did. B major, sorry, D major, F sharp minor, B minor, G major. And then you can integrate a couple different ones. You know what I like to do? Like start on the tonic, so you gotta use this. And then maybe the second one. And then instead of going to B, maybe just slide up to G. Slide right back down to D. You don't have to do the exact same thing. You just have to make it feel good with the vocal since it's a remix. Okay. I can't spend too much time on all these, so I hope that helped. Feel free to email me if you have any more questions. You want to start building your home studio, you have nothing. Would it be good to start with MIDI keys? You need a better PC. I don't know about PCs, man. I've been, unfortunately, spending all my money on Mac on Apple for my whole life. ever since I started music when I went to college, I had a MacBook Pro. I personally would go that route. I think Apple's products are so much more consistent and solid. And let's be real, like you'll have to switch over at some point. I don't know any professionals that use PC. It's an amateur's device. I'm just gonna say how it is. I mean, it's cheaper, so you have that advantage, but you can't use Logic. I don't think you can use Ableton. Those are the two, like, pretty much just widely recognized platforms of making music. You'd have to use FL Studio, which is, no one really uses that once you get to a certain level. I would try to get a laptop. I would try to do a student discount or something. You just get a MIDI controller. Sorry, I'm catching up on this. Gasso. Hi, Donnie. Can I play Fix You? You can play Fix You. Oh, you want me to play the... Maybe if I have time, I'll play it on piano. How many brass strings? Okay, I'm going to play Gasso's track, and then I'll answer that question. So everybody hold tight for a sec. This is a track from Jacob Gasso, just called Introduction. I love these textures in the beginning. Like the birds and all the ambient, whatever.
It's always now. However much you may feel like you need to plan for the future or minimize your risks, reality is now. We are subjectively unaware of what our minds are doing. So when we think about what matters, is consciousness and its contents. Consciousness is everything. Our experience of the world and those who care about it matter.
I like that voiceover. It needs to be louder.
For us, is how can we truly
feel? Yeah, okay.
How can we create lives that truly feel? Given that these lives come to an end.
Woo! Fuck yeah! Yeah, I know! Billy loves this too! Amazing! Oh, I wanted it to keep going! Okay. I would double that drop and then do the outro, because it's only a minute 56. You can get it to a minute or 215 or 230. Dude, nice. Really nice work. A couple things. I would choose between that, like, sort of 1950s radio voiceover. It's cool. A lot of guys are doing that right now in their intros. Choose between that or this sort of ambient ostinato type vocal that you have. This thing. Cool. That was cool too, but I wouldn't have them both going at the same time. I also would make them louder. Whatever you're going to pick, make that the main element. This part was sick right here.
Come to an end.
Everything.
Given that these lives come,
these
to,
lives
an
come to an end. Dude, this gave me the fucking chills. This is amazing. The drums need to be a lot louder. Some of your harmony. This one's good. That chord's a little off. I think you can make it land a little bit more with a better bass. What is it? That third one too, it just feels a little bit murky. I can't figure out where the harmonic texture is. And coming back to that is good. It's all good. You see how that chord's a little bit muddy, that one? Yeah, so I would just work on that. I love that big hit, then the side chain without the hit, then the big hit, then the side chain without the hit. Yeah, really nice. I'll email you about this. This is cool. Really, really cool. What tempo is this at? What are you working with? You have no music theory knowledge. That's okay. Just play around with some of the harmony. Oops. And then you're just going down. Yeah. 84. Cool. Yeah, that's great. That's great. Really, really nice work. Okay, there was one other question. I only have a few more minutes. What did El Fuego say? How many layers of brass strings and percussion you add? Way too fucking many. Way too many. So I used to do it to where like, oh, this doesn't sound quite right, so let me add more. That's the wrong approach. It's definitely the wrong approach. You have to have all your sounds sounding right, and then you can add more to achieve something that maybe one of them doesn't do on its own, but never layer to cover up something that doesn't sound good. If it doesn't sound good by itself, it's not going to sound good with something else squashed on top of it, right? Having said that, I don't know. I probably use 6 or 7 individual brass instruments. Each of those is like, you know, a 12 horn lead line or like a big low brass stem or patch or something like that. Strings, I usually use one big orchestral, like one full string complement. Then I'm usually playing chords to sketch on, and then like I break it out into the individual instruments. Usually the violins need to punch through when those are singing the melody. So that's generally what I emphasize. Percussion, same thing. I'm really trying to get away from like overlaying percussion because too much low end just like drowns out a track and it fucks up the headroom, you know? So I'm trying to be a little bit more careful there. But at any given time, some of the big orchestral stuff, you know, there's 200 some tracks in the whole arrangement. Nice, man. Yeah, I remember that. Yeah, happy birthday for sure. Really appreciate that. Yeah, and as I said, yeah, I oh, here's crazy effects. Shit, we have a minute. So I'm not gonna be able to do this. I'll email you, okay? Crazy effect. Sorry if I'm saying that wrong. I will email you feedback for that. Guys, feel free to send me demos. I might not be able to get to them immediately because I have a lot of other stuff that I'm working on, but I promise I will, and I appreciate you guys sending your stuff. Really appreciate you guys tuning in. These have been really awesome. I'm really happy to connect with you guys and be able to talk about things. Clean strings and brass. It depends on what it calls for, to be honest. You know, don't put an effect on there just to put an effect on there. Put an effect in there because you want to achieve a desired result in the track, right? So like if I distort a vocal or strings or brass, I usually distort my lead horn. You know, if I put like a lead French horn in a drop, which I did like on the Potions remix, or I'm doing on another track with Miles Away right now, it's to make it punch out because I want it to be separated from all the other synth elements. So I distort the shit out of the that lead horn to achieve a separation effect and to make it gritty. But I wouldn't just do it for the hell of it, because it doesn't, you know, you don't want it to seem out of place. Strings are usually clean. Yeah, and I'm glad you guys are meeting each other on here. This is awesome. I mean, there's so many talented producers. It's just, stay true to yourself. Don't buy into situations that don't feel good because you think it's going to propel your career. It doesn't end up doing anything for you in the long run. And I really do believe that. Just keep making music that you're excited about. And a lot of the stuff I've done in the past has just been me, you know, like Fix You. I didn't think it was going to have success. I just had an idea that I really wanted to do this. There was no promotion behind it. You know, Hide and Seek, same sort of thing, although that was like a process.
Potions remix, I had to do that in literally 2 days and turn it in, and it like turned out to be something incredible because I didn't have time to second guess all my choices. Same thing with Love Is Gone. Actually, little known fact, I'm actually collaborating with Dylan Matthew on a track. So that's pretty fucking sweet, and that came from all that. So yeah, just do your own thing, sculpt your own view, find inspiration, but always know that at some point you want to like find your own way of telling your own story, you know, as simply as that can be put. Yeah, but I really appreciate you guys tuning in. El Fuego, don't worry. I think I can download these and I can put these, I'm going to put this on my Instagram live, on the IG live page or whatever I can. Yeah, I really appreciate it. You guys, thank you for tuning in. Thank you for hearing me. Thank you for sending me demos. I'm always here. Keep connecting. And, yeah, let's keep fucking doing this thing. All right. I might not be able to download it anymore, says my girlfriend. Uh-oh. I think I can post it right to the IGTV. Okay. All right. Cheers, everybody. Have a great Saturday, or Sunday, wherever you are. And yeah, I will do this again. I'll do this again soon because when I'm going to be traveling, I'm going to be wanting to connect more. I won't be in the studio, but I'll just do it. You know, I don't have to be. Maybe I'll find a piano. I love you too. My girl, she's the best. I'll do another one of these in a few weeks. Thank you guys. Amazing, amazing work. Oh, okay, fine. I'll play Fix You right at the end. I'm not gonna sing it. Or do you want me to just play along with it? Okay. Is this thing gonna end soon? Fine. 2 minutes left. I'll play you out with Fix You. I don't even really know the chords anymore. Ready for the big part?